Oceans make up 71% of the surface of the Earth, yet we know less about the bottom of the ocean than we do about the surface of the moon. While we haven't found any lunar gemstones yet, the ocean is full of them, and you don't need the key to a treasure chest to get them. Today, we're gonna take a look at some of the coolest treasures found in Davy Jones' locker. First off, let's get something out of the way. I know many of you are probably thinking, oh, cool, Natalie's gonna talk about pearls. And I will, just not today. There is so much variety in history surrounding pearls that we think maybe they deserve their own video. Let us know what you think in the comments. For now, let's talk about a different organic gemstone, coral. Coral is a product of a coral polyp, a living, breathing saltwater animal. They are integral to the balance of the ocean's ecosystems, just like plants are on land. There are several hundred species of coral found all over the world, but most of the material used for jewelry comes from just two species, Corallium rubrum and Corallium japonicum. Coral has been used in jewelry for thousands of years. We even have evidence of coral jewelry from Egyptian and prehistoric European burials. The Romans hung coral around their children's necks to protect them from dangers outside, and the Gauls ornamented their weapons and helmets with it. Middle-aged Italians would Okay, wait, no, that doesn't sound right. In the Middle Ages, Italians believed wearing it could protect you from the evil eye and helped against infertility. Native Americans believed wearing it brought joy. At least that one I can agree with. Coral has been on Earth for so long that many ancient specimens have had time to fossilize, making for coral jewelry with a twist. Fossils offer glimpses into Earth's past, and the ocean is chock full of them. You probably are familiar with ammonites. They were an ancient cephalopod, like the squid and the octopus, that cruised around the ocean eating little aquatic pill bugs and mollusk larvae. And like much of life on Earth at the time, they could get huge, over 2 meters in diameter. What really elevates these fossils from scientific marble to beautiful rarity is when the shell is replaced during fossilization by aragonite. The result is a stunningly rainbow-hued fossil and the source of the gemstone we call ammolite. It's like the shiny Pokemon of fossils. The layer of aragonite creates an interference effect as light passes through it, resulting in an iridescent light show. The primary source of ammolite is in Alberta, Canada, and a good-looking specimen can be worth tens of thousands of dollars. Gotta catch them all is starting to sound like a pretty expensive undertaking. From one fossil to another, let's take a look at one that's a little easier to find. You don't even need a shovel, but you might need a bathing suit. I'm talking about Baltic amber. It gets its name from its primary source, the Baltic Sea. It just washes up on the shore there. It releases from the seafloor, and since it's less dense than the surrounding salt water, they just pop up to the surface, swept along by the currents, until they're found on the shore. But Natalie, amber comes from trees. How could it be floating out of the sea? There aren't any trees down there. Astute, there are not. But there were. Remember, the Baltic Sea is only about 13,000 years old. Amber takes tens of millions of years to form, and the oldest stuff is hundreds of millions of years old. If we turn the clock back far enough, you'll find that the floor of what is now the Baltic Sea was once a forest teeming with prehistoric fauna, and of course, trees. It's the sap from these trees that today pops up off the floor like a champagne cork and finds its way into your jewelry. There are plenty of myths around the origins of Baltic amber, but one of my favorites comes from Lithuania. Basically, the god of thunder got mad that his daughter was in a relationship with a mortal fisherman and hurled a bolt of lightning down to destroy her underwater amber palace, the remains of which washed up on the shore. Classic. With the exception of maybe amber, you'd expect to find most of those gemstones underwater. But what about one you don't expect? What about diamond? One of the largest diamond mining operations in the world is happening underwater off the coast of Namibia. In 1991, the famous De Beers Company bought mining rights to 3,000 square miles of the Namibian seafloor, and with onshore diamond mines starting to wear thin, this investment has begun to pay off. In 2016, the operation produced 1.2 million carats of diamonds using a ship called Mafuta. This word is derived from several African dialects and roughly means fat or oil, evoking a sense of power and wealth. Imagine naming your ship that. What a power move. That's like naming your son Prince. Anyway, the ship sucks up sediment from the seafloor like that thing from the Teletubbies, and it gets processed inside the ship, requiring minimal human interaction. Mifuda also transports Butcher, a glorified claw machine that rolls around on the bottom picking up diamonds off the floor like loose change. A real dynamic duo, the Batman and Robin of undersea diamond mining. Let's change gears and talk about a far less successful underwater undertaking, gold mining. There's an estimated 20 million tons of gold in the ocean. And when I say in the ocean, I mean quite literally in the ocean. Teeny tiny gold particles are swirling around out there, but you can't exactly just pluck them out of the water. 1 liter of ocean water has about 13 billionths of a gram of gold. That's not a lot. But if there were a way to get it, you'd be looking at around $770 trillion worth of gold. For reference, the projected GDP of the entire world economy for 2019 is about $80 trillion. Are you interested yet? That's the kind of pitch that Pastor Prescott Ford Jernigan made to investors back in the 1890s. He managed to raise money to fund an operation to extract gold from Long Island Sound through mercury and electricity treatments. He called it the Gold Accumulator. Come on, Pastor PF, even Dr. Doofenshmirtz wouldn't come up with a name like that.
Well, it does what the name implies.
The plan was so simple, it was brilliant. He would bring potential backers to the edge of the pier and invite them to pour mercury that they had brought themselves into a special zinc-lined bucket. He would then lower the bucket into the water below the pier and turn on a special battery connected to it. Meanwhile, underwater, Jernigan's associate would pour out the mercury and replace it with some that was infused with gold. Then the bucket would get hauled back up and the mercury sent off to be tested. Of course, it would come back positive, and of course, backers bought it. His operation eventually got so large, he created an actual company called Electrolytic Marine Salt Company, and at one point employed 100 people. The scheme pulled in over $1 million, about $24 million today, before it all came crashing down. One of the original insiders decided he wanted to be paid to keep quiet. When they didn't pay him enough, he revealed the secret to the world, and the bamboozled investors were furious. So the pastor did what anyone would do. He made like Steve Miller. He took the money and ran. Many people have tried more legitimate ways of getting at the ocean's gold supply, but they've all come up short. If someone does figure it out, there will be a whole lot more gold to buy. Talk about flooding the market. So, what would you name your underwater gold mining scheme? Leave a comment down below and don't forget to like, subscribe, and ring that bell. Thanks for watching.